Music isn't merely sound. It's a sensory experience that demands visuals to match the beat. Enter Boris FX's Continuum 2024 with Audio Visualizer. Now you have the magic wand to make your graphics dance. Choose your tune, decide on a style, and witness your visuals breathe and flow. Dive into a range of preset animations in the effects editor, preview in sync with selected audio, and make any change you need, all with a specialized effects workspace. Mirror your music's beat with different visualizer modes. Infuse it with vibrant hues and journey into new visual dimensions with built-in effects like polar warp. With BCC Plus Audio Visualizer, sounds and sights unite effortlessly. Enjoy the added dimension of tweaking your visualizer with built-in mirroring effects, peak hold, film glow, and 3D DVE. Attach your visualizer to any footage using the power of the award-winning Mocha Planner Tracker. Dive into a world where music meets motion. BCC Plus Audio Visualizer is available in Boris FX Continuum 2024. Download a free trial today or renew your subscription or upgrade and support plan at borisfx.com. Want to get started with this versatile effect? Join me, Nick Harauz, as I show you the ropes. Okay, I'm going to be demonstrating Audio Visualizer inside of Premiere Pro, but this works in any host that Continuum 2024 supports. So you can try this inside of After Effects, Final Cut Pro, DaVinci Resolve, Vegas, to name a few. So here is the clip and the audio that I've decided to work with. I'm going to move my playhead to the beginning of the timeline, make this full frame, and then just press the spacebar to play it back. Once I press escape, the end goal of this is to have a visualizer integrated with our footage. Before that, we'll get familiar with the basics. Let's apply Audio Visualizer to our clip source here. I'll head to my video effects in the effects panel. We want to go to the BCC time category where we'll see Audio Visualizer, which I'll drag and drop. You'll see that we'll need to select an external media file. So I've already exported the audio in my timeline to my system so that Audio Visualizer will see it. Inside of After Effects, you can access this as a layer. Under the BCC Visualizer effect, in Effect Controls, let's click on the Select Audio checkmark. Select our audio or sound source and choose to open it. We'll be presented by a series of frequencies. And let's just play that back to see this in sync. Now there's a lot that we can do with this effect, and a great way to become familiar with the possibilities is the effects editor. So in Effect Controls, I'll click on the effects editor badge, and on the left be presented with a series of presets. Simply click on a preset and you'll see a visual of that inside the viewer. Inside of Continuum 2024, if I press the play button, we'll be able to preview that in real time, although not hearing the audio, but this is a great way to switch between various sources that we can become more familiar with. Even better, when you're on a particular source, twirl down a couple of the parameter properties on the right-hand side, and then you can see them update their values based on the preset that's selected. Now, the effects editor has a couple other things that we can take advantage of. If I look here to the top, we can do a split screen comparison, but that's going to do it with our original clip, which isn't so helpful in this situation. So I'm going to turn that off. And instead, I'm going to take a snapshot of this preset. I'm then going to select another preset. And you'll notice next to the snapshot icon, a computer view snapshot icon. If we click on that, we can do a side-by-side comparison of two visualizers with our current selected track. Since we're going to get started with the basics, let's cancel out of here. So I'll click on cancel and make sure to not save the changes. We're back in Premiere Pro with the default visualizer. And under effect controls, I'm going to twirl down the generator section. First off, we have two audio styles that we can choose from. Right now it's set to frequency, but we also have waveform. Once you select your desired audio style, we have a number of different ways of displaying those waveforms. So we can display it as dots, bars, or even single dots. I'll set this to bars, and we can choose a resolution to show more waveforms in this view. Now, based on what's selected here in the generator section, we can go further down and we'll see a section dedicated to this waveform. We have different styles for this, so absolute values is what it's currently set to. But if I set this to range, it's going to chop off the top and bottoms of the waveform to give a different look. We'll also see a duration here. So from left to right, this is currently displaying 33 milliseconds of audio from the track. If I increase this number to 100, we're going to see more waveforms. In fact, if I play this back, we'll get a scrolling effect. And notice how we're scrolling through our audio. If I escape out of here and now increase the duration to a value of 500, this scrolling will become a lot more evident. Now, lower values, if I change the duration to something like 20, we're much more zoomed in on our range style waveform. And you'll see here that while we don't get that scrolling technique, it is moving quickly because of that small duration. Last but not least, we can offset our audio. Let me twirl up waveform, and I'm going to switch this audio style back to frequencies. There are certain sections that only activate if frequencies is enabled. Let's change the vertical style to dots so we can see this and bring down the resolution to 32. We can increase the scale of our frequencies to take up more of the screen, as well as play with the width, height, and density of them. One really unique effect is taper. If I enable this, you'll notice that the actual dots closer to the top of the frequency are much smaller than the ones here at the bottom. If I change this to relative, this is not only going to affect the dots here from top to bottom, but also in some cases from left to right. We can choose dual access, as well as invert the style for some really unique looks. In this case, I'll just leave taper enabled at its default. I'll twirl up its properties, and let's now look at peak hold. Peak hold is going to add an extra layer of dimension to your visualizer. So whenever it reaches a peak, we'll get a little hold taking place based on the falloff time set here, not to mention the scale and the color values. I'll increase the falloff time to be a value of 1 second in this case, move to the beginning of my timeline, and let's play this back. You may be able to see peak holds on our lower frequencies here. Let me escape out of full screen playback again. And you may wonder also why the color of this peak hold is set to white, but right now we're seeing a gradient across our frequencies. If we head into the gradient section and disable it, now we'll see the original colors of our frequencies, not to mention the peak hold, which we're able to switch. So I'll set the peak hold in this case to blue, and the color of our overall frequencies to a lighter cyan. Excellent. Twirling up the gradient properties, last is frequency tuning, where from left to right, we're seeing our low frequencies to our high frequencies based on a minimum and maximum frequency value, not to mention certain cutoffs. At any point in time, we can come in here to adjust this value. In fact, I'll make the minimum frequency 0 in this case and increase the maximum frequency to 5,000 and also play with the smoothness value. Now, a low smoothness is going to have more extremes at the various frequency levels, where a high smoothness value will even this out. Play around with this amount in motion to get a sense for what you can do with your waveform. Now, I want to twirl up the frequency tuning section and disable the peak hold. After we've designed our bass generator, which I'll also twirl up, we can start to distort this. I'm going to twirl down the mirror section here and enable this to now see that we have a mirror of our waveform on the right-hand side based on the center and angle value. If I start to increase the center to a higher number, you'll see the mirror change. Alternatively, we could go to our pre-transform section, move up our original generator in terms of its Y position, then come to the mirror where we can change the angle, in this case, an entire 90 degrees, and its center position for a more unique look. And again, this will change over time, moving back to the beginning and doing a full screen playback. Now back under the mirror effects, depending on how it is set up, we could also have a number of reflections or tiles on the edges of this based on the center as well as the angle value. In this case, we won't see this update. I'm going to turn off the mirror settings and we'll go to our second distortion effect, which is polar warp, keeping the pre-transformations as is. So once I enable this, we can see our frequencies now mapped to a circle, which has an inner and an outer radius. Let me decrease the inner radius, as well as the outer radius, I'm going to decrease as well. So we can see that this happens to be a repeated pattern or wrapped on both the X and Y values. Let me set the tile amount to no on both of these values. So we just have one polar warp and I'll change that in terms of its inner and outer radius for the look that I'm going for. Last, I'll change its center position there in the frame. Now, once you've made your distortion changes, we can still transform it in terms of its position as well as rotate it in 3D space. For this, I'm going to go to the global transform section and enable it. And let's just look at the tumble values, which will rotate this in X. I'll undo that, as well as the spin values, which will rotate this in Y. This could be great if you're trying to integrate it into footage like we are in this example. Now, before we begin to play with this a bit further, I'm going to go down to the bottom of the effect where it says background. And I'm going to twirl down those properties. By default, the background mode is set to solid, which is why we can't see our footage that we began with. I'll change this to source. And now we can see the visualizer with the clip underneath. I'll twirl that up for the time being, go back to my global transform, where I'll play around with this polar warped audio visualizer's position, scale it up, rotate it, and then go back to the polar warp just to make the inner radius bigger so we can see this lady's head. So we've built the base look of our visualizer, and then we started to warp it with both the mirror and built-in polar warp effects. Now it's time to perfect the look with stylization, as well as color. I'm going to twirl up the polar warp properties, and let's take a look at film glow underneath global transform. And you'll notice if I enable it, we get a glow over our overall polar warp. You can play around with the color, the intensity, the radius, not to mention you can enable a secondary glow to add even more color and have the same controls that you do for the primary glow. In addition to this, there's a whole color correction section where we can shift the hue of the entire audio visualizer, decrease its saturation, etc. I'm just going to click on the icons to reset these parameters. Now, the best part is that we can take this even a step further, where we can have our visualizer tracked to the scene. For this, we need to go to the very top of the effect. And here we can see our Mocha mask and track section. If I twirl this down, let's go to Mocha parameter track, where we now have two bounding boxes. One represents the corner pin, which is essentially how our audio visualizer is going to be in terms of it, the perspective of the scene. What we are actually going to use to track is the outer box. And I'm going to drag the outermost handles over this woman's face, knowing that it's not a perfectly flat plane, but the texture itself should allow us to track this easily. I'll press Command A just to make the points really sharp here, and we'll leave the corner pin shape as well as its bounding box the same so it doesn't change when we go back into the host. Now, in this case, I'm just looking for the movement in the woman's face and click on translation. Let's now begin our track by tracking backwards in the essential panel. We can see it's just the position data, not rotation or scale, because I disabled that. And now I'll track forward. Excellent. Even though her hand got in the way a little bit of our tracked area, it still seemed to hold on to that texture. Now, I'm going to close out Mocha Continuum and save the data, most importantly, where we're heading now back into Premiere Pro. And because the global transform settings are on, we'll automatically see this track. So let me move to the beginning and do a full screen playback. If we head back down to the background section of Visualizer, we even have blend modes that we can play with. In this case, I'll just choose screen so it blends into our footage a little bit better and even up the mix with background. Now, we're not just limited to one visualizer. In fact, some compelling looks with footage can involve two or even three visualizers. On some of the presets that you'll see created by John Dickinson, you could apply multiple presets to a solid and then create a really unique look. In this instance, I'm going to twirl up the current visualizer and now just apply another. And in the case of the other, I'll select the same audio track that we just saw. Right away, head to the background settings, where I'll make sure the mode is set to source. And let's go to the effects editor, where I'm going to choose a frequency preset. So looking at the existing presets, I'm going to select the central waveform movement. And in fact, just make sure that its background again is set to source. I'll apply this, heading back to Premiere Pro. In this case, so we can focus on this new visualizer, I'll turn off the first one. We can head to Global Transform, which I will enable. And I wanted to make you aware of this corner pin section. One great way of using this is to go to the top of the audio visualizer effect. And in Premiere Pro, if I go to 50%, we have these handles for our corner pin that were used by Mocha Pro, and we can use to position elements within our shot. In this case, I just want to get this to the same perspective of the building on the left-hand side. Okay, that's looking good. I'll twirl up the global transform settings, go back to background, or I'll choose a different blending mode in this case. Let's go with screen and mix this with the original. I'll twirl up that audio visualizer. And if I go to my effects, I'm just going to do a search for looks. And under the film style category, add BCC plus looks, and from the effects editor, choose a preset just to integrate everything together. So in this case, early sunset, and at the bottom of the parameters, I'll add some grain to this shot, leaving it at monochrome and everything at its defaults. Let's apply that, head back into Premiere Pro, and see the final result. We're just touching the surface of what you can do with BCC Plus Audio Visualizer. You can use this for motion graphics and several other treatments, and the sky is the limit when you start to combine multiple visualizer effects. Don't forget to subscribe and check us out at borisfx.com, not to mention a tutorial coming up from John Dickinson specifically about how to use Audio Visualizer in motion graphic workflows. Thanks so much for watching.